Needles aren't cutting needles. Does everyone know the difference between there's cutting needles, like a, and then there's blunt needles, and there's spinal needles which pop things as opposed to cut things. So if you go and hit a nerve ending or a nerve with your needle, you're probably not going to chop it in half and hurt anyone. So some people say, oh yeah, but you've heard about thoracic epidurals and things. For sure, you can skewer something, but we're not doing thoracic epidurals, we're literally doing a lumbar puncture. So we're in a really safe place. I was going to say there's a couple of positions you can be in. You can be sitting up, and I prefer to be sitting up, but it's got its limitations, or lying down. Okay, so let's talk about the sitting up one first. How would you, because positioning is really important for this. What position do you want to be sitting up? Angry, archy cat, feet on the seats, perfect. Yep, and so you're really opening up the spinous processes. Yep, cool. So the couple of things I find, I'm not sure, Laurie, you've got any other tricks. My way of doing it, sometimes it's hard to get people to do it, is I put my hands, I say arch your back like an angry cat. Everyone knows what that means. They arch your back over, hips 90 degrees out. You can always change if you're not getting where you want, but usually hips, good place to start is hips at 90 degrees. So change the bed height to get that right. And then I'll grab their shoulders and I'll say, if I was really rough, and I'll rotate them around. If I was really rough and kept on doing this, and they automatically keep on doing that. You know, you don't have to actually twist them, you just grab them and give them a little gentle. And then once they've done that, you say, now stick your bum out at me, and they tend to stick their bum out. So it's stick your bum out, is just do this, and then stick your bum out. And that for me works quite well for most people. It's good enough. And what you'll see when you look in their back is that it will pop out at you. And then you're, oh, perfect. Sitting up, you can't do opening pressures. That's the only thing about it. So if you're worried about infections, sit them up if they're happy to sit up, if they're well enough to sit up, if their blood pressure is not in the boots and things. If they're sick and they need to be lying down, or if you want to know what the opening pressure is, they have to be lying down. So you can't do an opening pressure when they're sitting in a chair. But it's much easier to get an LP usually if they're sitting up. So that's my default is sitting up unless I've got a reason not to. Just quickly anatomy-wise, because this is here, it's not a bad thing to go through. You're aiming for that little hole. So that little hole in there. So positioning is one thing, and that's what's going to really open these things up and make that hole bigger. Okay, so what's the anatomy you're going through? So it's firm. So if you put your needle under the skin and let go, it will just flop down. But if you stick it into here with a syringe on the back, it will sit like a little dagger. It sits down here. Oh, cool, I'm in the ligament now. Okay, and I haven't hit bone, so I must be going somewhere, right? Probably. Then you go further in, and what do you hit next, say, after that? What's the next sort of ligament thing you hit after the spinous ligament? Close enough. So, the next sort of landmark you really care about, flavum, ligamentum flavum. So what does it feel like with a needle? That's firm. What does it feel like when you hit ligament flavum often? Where does that go? Where does that end? Epidural space. What's next after the epidural space? Dura. You pop through the pleura, you often will feel a pop, and that's where you want to be. That's where you get your CSF back. So just get an idea. So if you think about it, if you're going slowly, hopefully you'll feel skin soft cut, subcut stuff, firm, firm, crunchy, crunchy, pop. Okay, and if you remember that, it actually works quite well lots of the time, not all the time, but quite a bit of time it works. Bone is hard, and that sounds like a dumb thing. Yeah, great, but it's true. If you hit bone, it's different to firm. It's hard. So if you're putting a needle in and you hit bone, you're in the wrong place. Okay, you might be a bit offline, you might be hitting one of the transverse processes, you might be hitting the spinous process more likely, you might be hitting one of the pedicles, you might be something, you're not where you want to be, you're not in that nice hole. So if you hit bone, stop and start again, and we'll show you how we do that. Is that cool as far as the anatomy goes? Cool, okay. So let's have the person sitting up, because it mannequin's sitting up, so that's good. So sitting up, oh, firstly, aseptic technique. Bear below the elbows. No watch. Check, check. Good positioning, consent, all that stuff. That's all done. I'll go 1% with adrenaline. I like 10 mils of it. I like lots of local because I don't want to have to keep on going back and going back. And people are scared of lumbar punctures. Like the patient is scared of them usually. So if it hurts straight away and you're causing them pain, A, it's not nice, and B, those get worse and worse and worse during the procedure. It doesn't have to be a painful procedure to put a spinal, to put a lumbar puncture in. So it can be very, so I like 10 mils of 1% with, I think get a blue needle. This is talking about adults, but you know, for kids, just put in less distance, but get a blue needle with your 10 mils, and I'll then go squirt on the back. This is me. I'll put a bit of liquid on the back. So if you feel a bit cold on your back, squirt. It's all cleaned. Squirt, so it's now wet. Why do I do that? because I can feel the bumps much easier. This is my little tricks that works. If you're putting your finger down skin, you tend to get, with your gloves on, you tend to get caught in the skin. The skin gets caught on your gloves and you don't really, whilst here you glide down, you can feel the space. It's so much easier if things are a bit wet. Okay, so I tend to put a bit of local on the back and just so I can feel it. What am I feeling for now? Yep, so the top part of the hip, you let crest at the top. So there's the top of the hips, perfect. And then what do I do next? Find the middle. And what am I feeling for? Spinous processes, what kind of level is that gonna be about? Give or take, we're hopers at this, so L4-5. So I can go one or two levels above or a couple of levels below. Definitely one above, maybe two, or definitely a couple below. Okay, so that's a pretty good place to start. So I'm gonna push fairly firm on your hips. There we go, come around the middle, and what I'm feeling, I have to tell what I'm feeling a bone there and a bone there. Okay, and what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna run down between them and find the biggest divot point, okay? So that's my trick. So sometimes it's the very top of the space, sometimes it'll be the bottom of the space, usually it's in the middle of the space, but that's the biggest divot point for sure, and that's what I'm gonna aim for, okay? So I'm gonna put a little dot, I'm gonna either indent it, or I tend to swap over and put my little finger, my other finger, my index finger in that place, and then I'm in the right place. But I'm really importantly positioned, I'm midline. I'm not on the side, I'm midline. I then get my blue needle with my 10 mil syringe. Okay, it's gonna be a bit of a sting, it's a 2 second sting. You ready? You're right, you're gonna do really well. So warn them before you sting them, always, obviously. I know people say, don't say it's gonna sting. It does sting. I just say it's gonna be a quick sting. And I go through the skin, I don't inject anything, and I go all the way down to the hilt, okay, in an adult. It may be if they are this tiny little person, I might not go all the way in. But with a blue needle, with most adults, you're gonna be fine. You're not gonna go through anything you shouldn't go through like a juror. So go in to the hilt, and then I know that if I haven't hit bone, I'm probably in the right place. So if I go in and I hit bone, what I might then do is stop, come back a bit and angle up and go in, or angle down a bit and go in. There's a feeler needle for me, okay? So you need to come out of the ligament first, change your direction, go down 30 degrees or up 30 degrees, okay? And just give it a go. So instead of having to go to another level and put new here. So here we go, I'll put the local in. So here we are, I'm in, cool, it all went all the way in, awesome. So now I'm gonna go inject, really firm, I'm in the ligament, that makes me feel good. I'm in the ligament, I can't inject the local in the ligament very easily. Firm, okay, it's loosening up a bit now. So as I come out, fan it. So, and as I come to the surface, just knowing that it's actually at the surface it's going to sting. So you get to the end and it starts to balloon up a little bit. You get this sort of coming up a little bit and they go, oh, it hurts a bit. So I always want them, this is the last stingy bit. There's a little bit of a sting now, just the local going in. Sting, 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 you're doing really well. You got a little swelling there. I tend to click off my syringe and just leave the needle in there. So you really still, that's the worst part done. I say it's the worst part done, and we're doing really well. Because it is the worst part done for them. It shouldn't be painful anymore. And then they go, it was fine, cool. And it's fine. In their brain, the needle's in, it's all started. So it's all good. So the needle's in, this is my little blue needle's in. I have time for that local to work. I get my, okay, this, I don't use a cannula. So this is a special needle, it's a pencil point needle or a quinky needle, but it's a needle which doesn't cut the dura, it pops it, okay? And so it's thought that it's gonna be, oh gosh, I don't know how it's gonna go. It's like a little pencil point. So it doesn't, yeah, so instead of putting a big tear, what's the problem with putting a big tear in the dura with a cutting needle? When I pull it out, what's gonna keep on leaking out? CSF. Yeah, you get that annoying post-dural puncture headache. So when they lie down flat, it goes away. When they sit up, it hurts. And that might just go away by itself for some time, or it might need something like a blood patch. So you don't want to do it to someone if you don't need to. Definitely old people don't get it as much, but you won't avoid it. So 22 gauge comes in the pack. So we'll just use this. So once again, I've got to find where it was, but that's where my blue needle is. So my blue needle is there. I pull out my blue needle, put it somewhere safe, and I put this needle instead, exactly where my blue, same hole as my blue needle. Okay, and now I can go in a little bit, but now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hold, so everyone's got their own little tricks. I wanna feel those sensations that we were talking about before, so I don't wanna go, oh geez, going too fast. It's not gonna matter. I'm probably not gonna hurt them if I do it, but I don't wanna do it. So I want to be able to stop when I feel the pop. So I've got my hand, this hand is my pushing hand, and this hand is my resisting hand. So this hand's pushing it in, and this hand is leaning against their back and is actually resisting the movement. So it doesn't, if I suddenly give, that will stop me. Now it's just that balancing act of going, I tend to bounce, I'm a bit of a bounce, but I tend to go in. It's firm now, I can feel, actually can honestly feel that quite firm. Firm, firm, but I'm not just pushing, I'm bouncing a bit. Firm, 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 firm. Oh, it feels like a ballooning, ballooning, ballooning. Pop. I felt it go pop literally then. So, felt it go pop. Take that out. And I've got some CSF coming out there. So, CSF coming out is good. What colour should it be? So, talk about turbid and straw and, what's that?
Yeah, straw.
Straw. And to me, it's just clear. It looks like water. So, I don't know where the straw in. It's weird, isn't it? It's warm as well. Because some people think, oh, maybe that's my local coming out. Because this actually was a really thin person, and I got it at like 3 centimetres. I'm like, oh, is that just my local? So you can let drip into your hand a bit, and you can go, oh, it's actually pretty warm. It's a bit sticky. It's CSF. Okay, so that sounds like a dumb thing. You can actually test. You can put on paper and things. But I'll just have a feel and make sure. It's more if you're putting epidurals in, that's useful. But is this something you can do? If it's not clear, there's probably a problem if it's not clear. It might be a bit red. Does that matter if it's a bit red? They're like pinkish? Yeah. Does that matter? Like if you're going to cause any big problems if you've done a traumatic tap? No. So don't stress. It's okay. It's cool. There's lots of little vessels, epidural vessels along the way you can easily go through. It's just, it happens or not. Cool. So now, these aren't labeled. I don't know why these aren't labeled, but they come labeled. 1, 2, and 3, believe it or not. And you don't have to shake them empty either each time. They usually come empty. Little one's number 1. They'll have number 1 on it. 2 and 3. And just, 3, 4. I do 4 or 5 drops in each, depending how fast it's going. But so out it came. And I go, awesome, cool. So they've done that. So it's all come out. I've got 3 or 4 drops in each. And it's all done. And then I can just pull that out. 2 questions I've got for you. I'll just pull the thing out of their back. So they have to lie on the ground, on the back for 3 hours. What do I do now? I've got a little hole. I put a Band-Aid on. Okay, that's pretty technical. What do I do now? Do they have to lie in bed for 5 days or what can they do? They were walking beforehand. Can they walk to the toilet now? Yep. So they might need bed rest because they're sick, because they're decreased blood pressure, etc. But if they were walking beforehand, they can walk afterwards. So they don't need to do bed rest after a lumbar puncture. So that's one thing. And what do I send these things off for? I send it off to the lab. It's 2 a.m. I call the lab in. It's not until morning. You don't wait till morning. What do I ask the lab for? So MCS, PCRs, biochem. Perfect. And look, at the end of the day, the lab will just do it for us anyway. So if you actually miss something, they're probably going to say, hey, did you want? Yes, please. But yeah, they'll send off. You don't have to PCR. You might want to say what the problem is. You don't have to write PCR for meningitis or meningitis. Just say PCR. I say bacterial and viral PCR. They'll do it anyway up here. So it's just say PCRs, MCS, biochem, and they'll do everything. And they'll do it urgently as well. If you just Chris quickly, the let's just go back to the needle being in. The needle was in. So once the needle's in, if you want to take their pressure, so here it is, it's in there, it's all good. So all I then, if they're lying flat, it comes with a manometer. Right? It's like an enemy. It's a manometer. You don't go that side. You go that side. As soon as it starts dripping out, you hold it up. You hold it up until the fluid comes up and stops. And that's your pressure.
So it's stupid question, Dave. If they're lying on their side, you mean up as in still towards the sky, not up towards the head?
Sorry, up and towards the sky, yeah. Up against gravity, yep, yep. And if they're sitting up like this, don't bother. It will just come out the top. And we've all done, I've fallen for that one in the past. I've done someone's pressure sitting up and gone, oh my gosh, I wasn't expecting that. And just because I was an idiot. So have it facing uphill, up towards the sky, yeah. And then when it stops. And then once that's done, undo that. And that's your first jar. Don't waste it all. Don't mix them in. But that goes into your first jar, your first bottle, and then collect the other bottles the same as you would before. Okay? So that's the opening pressure. You don't have to do it for everyone. I don't definitely don't do it for everyone, but if there's a reason to do it, be sure. The question is, when wouldn't you do it? Would you have to do a CT before everyone? This is a vexed question. When would I want a CT scan before I do CT head before I do an LP. If they've definitely got sort of Cushing's kind of stuff, Cushing's response, but if they have a fit, if they're obtunded, honestly, if they've got sort of a change in mental state or they're fitting or they've got focal neurological signs, I'll do a CT first. That'd be me. It's actually not very common. Usually you suspect meningitis, you just do it. You don't have to do LP. You definitely do a CT every time before you do an LP. And there's always a question, did it cause the coning or was the coning going to happen anyway? The coning was probably going to happen anyway, but that's a different debate.
When you're all the way through and they say, oh, I just had a sharp pain, go down one leg. Are you good to crack on?
There's no perfect answer. I wouldn't crack on. I'd stop. It usually is skewed onto one side. So you use around the facet jointy kind of exiting nerve roots. So what I would do then, I say, which side, left or right? So if it's on the left, I'll pull it back a centimetre or however much I need to be able to reposition it, and I'll position it towards the other side and go in. There might be scoliotic, you might have got the angle wrong. Even a little bit to the side back here will end up a long way. If they're a big person, it'll end up a long way to the side deep down. So sharp pain down one side is really unusual for a lumbar puncture, and it just means you just need to come back and even out to the middle. Get the biggest space and stay midline. And often I'll put it in, I'll go, have you ever seen me put them in? I'll often put one in, and I'll go, oh no, I'll come back a bit and go in. I spend a fair bit of effort, not time, so it doesn't take much time, but I spend a fair bit of effort straight away getting it in that perfect midline. And I'll feel the spine up above and below. Because if you get that wrong, you can do all the work in the world and you won't get it in, potentially. You might, but you might not. But you do. Positions are really important.
One of the things that helped me a lot is if I hit bone or something with resistance from that very first time, I don't proceed until I go, hey, where do you feel this? I just tap on the end, and often they'll have a really good perception of, is it center, left, or right? And if it's center, I'm like, oh, great, I'm in the midline, I'm just going to re-angle. And if it's left or right, I'll just change. And often the next pass is the good one. So just being able to ask the patient where they think it is really useful.
That's very good. Yeah.
Are they usually pretty accurate? Or?
Yeah, like it's my kind of the gold standard for me for getting it quick.
If you hit bone, ask them.
Yeah, where is it? Well, cool, thanks for that. And then. Sometimes I just take it out completely and go 5 millimeters the other direction to avoid the hypotenuse kind of effect of a triangle.